Dear learners, welcome to NIOS Studio. I'm Chavi and today we'll study about biotechnology. So first, what is biotechnology? It's a technology based on biology. It's an area of science involving living systems and organisms to develop or make products for the benefit of humankind. So if we break the term biotechnology, it's bio plus technology. So bio refers to the living organisms. So basically, we are using different tools and different techniques to manipulate the living organisms so as to develop products which are beneficial to us. Next, we come to applications of biotech. So the various applications are, it can be used in health and medicine to fight infections, to develop vaccines and antibiotics, treat genetic disorders, and in forensics. Then in environment, we can use it for bioremediation. In agriculture, for controlling pests, food, and in drinks. And industrial applications include the production for cheese, yogurt, alcohol, etc. If we talk of health and medicine, so we have all heard about penicillin, which is extracted from Penicillium notatum. It's a fungi. And this is a drug, this is an antibiotic which is functioning against the bacteria, for example, which causes pneumonia and various other bacterial infections. So that's all basically using biotechnology. Then we all know about the criminal cases that are solved using DNA fingerprinting, which again is an application of biotech. We can further use biotech for cleaning up the environment where the toxic chemicals which are present in the environment. So using microbes which are genetically engineered, those toxic chemicals can be converted to non-toxic forms. Then coming to agriculture, so we have been able to develop certain varieties of plants which are resistant to pests, for example, BT cotton, then we have BT tobacco. Also, various pests have been genetically modified so as to they are sterile and they are not able to cause the disease. And fermentation, which we are all aware of, is another application of biotech, which is utilized to prepare curd, cheese, butter, etc. So next we look about the industrial applications first, how various microorganisms can be utilized for producing industrial products. So the microorganisms that we can use are fungi, bacteria, actinomycetes, which is a filamentous bacteria, and we can prepare products such as alcoholic beverages, yogurt, proteins, vitamins, antibiotics, antibodies, and biogas. Understanding fermentation first. So fermentation is the process where glucose is converted to ethyl alcohol, releasing CO2 and also, you know, it's an energy yielding process. And this is done by the yeast, it's a fungi, and the name of the yeast that is commonly used is Saccharomyces cerevisiae. And because it is used in both baking as well as brewing, we call it as baker's yeast as well as brewer's yeast. So it is used in baking purposes to prepare cakes, to prepare breads, and then further we can prepare alcoholic beverages, for example, wine, using yeast. Then we can also utilize bacteria to prepare yogurt and cheese. So there are different varieties of cheese available depending upon the type of bacteria that was used in the fermentation process. And yogurt, we have all seen how it is set at home, where we take a small amount of the curd, which is called as the starter or the inoculum, and we add it in milk, in lukewarm milk, and leave it for a few hours. So during this time, the starter curd is given the ambient conditions which is having the lactobacillus bacteria. And these bacteria, they multiply at a very high speed and they convert lactose, which is present in the milk, into lactic acid, which leads to the souring of the milk. And also the milk curdling enzyme will help in the curdling of milk into curd. Then the next application is in the preparation of antibiotics. So antibiotics are the substances which are produced by bacteria or fungi which inhibit the growth of other disease-causing microorganisms. So these antibiotics, basically they are produced from the friendly bacteria, you can say in a simpler term, which is used to, and so these products are extracted from these bacteria or fungi and they work against the disease causing pathogens. We can further classify antibiotics as broad spectrum antibiotics and narrow spectrum antibiotics. broad spectrum antibiotics can be used against more than one kind of pathogenic bacteria, for example erythromycin, chloramphenicol, and narrow spectrum antibiotics are used against a few pathogenic bacteria, for example streptomycin, penicillin, etc. Next application is in the production of vaccines. So vaccines are the dead or the weakened microbes which are injected into the body, which lead to the production of antibodies in our body. So these antibodies then further fight the disease causing foreign microbodies which are present in our body. So if these vaccines are prepared from the weakened disease causing microbes, these are called as first generation vaccines. When they are produced by genetic engineering, we call them as second generation vaccines, and when they are synthesized from chemicals, we call them as third generation vaccines. And coming to the production of vitamins. So vitamins, these are required in our body in micro quantities, and so we can even prepare these vitamins using microbes. For example, vitamin C was the first vitamin to be produced during fermentation process by using bacteria. Next is the production of biogas. So what happens in biogas? So it's basically we require agricultural waste, or mainly the organic waste, which can be the agricultural waste or the fecal waste, or you can talk about take manure, food waste, and we prepare a slurry where it is mixed with water in a certain ratio, and then it is fed into the bioreactor or a fermenter. So if in India we are the cow dung is commonly available, and it's available in large quantities, so we mainly use cow dung to prepare biogas. So this cow dung is already having methanogenic bacteria present, which is the methane producing bacteria. So, and the property of that is it respires anaerobically. So we have a fermenter into which the slurry is fed, and the methanogenic bacteria which is present in the cow dung, it will multiply, and then during that process it will carry out the fermentation process there, where it will release methane gas, and the whatever the slurry which has been left over now is called as the spent slurry. So biogas can further be utilized for cooking or lightening purposes, whereas the spent slurry can be utilized as a manure. So in a way it is advantageous to people living in rural areas, because we are using the biogas also, plus at the same time the spent slurry can be used as manure, and plus it is cheaper than LPG. So next we come to the next application of biotechnology, that is genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is when the genetic makeup of an organism is altered by inserting, deleting, or changing specific pieces of DNA. Identical copies can be made and stored in gene libraries. When conducting genetic engineering, the organisms that have their genetic material makeup altered are referred to as genetically modified organisms, or GMOs. It utilizes molecules that have been engineered through recombinant DNA technology. So basically in genetic engineering, we are manipulating the genetic makeup of an organism. So we can add certain sequence, we can delete a certain sequence, or we can completely remove a sequence and add a new one. So we use the tool of recombinant DNA technology. So let's understand the technique how we are using to prepare recombinant DNA. So before we understand the technique, we must know the tools which are required for recombinant DNA technology. So first we require the organism, the cells of the organism from where we need the gene of interest. So we'll suppose it's a bacteria from which we need to isolate the gene of interest. So that bacteria will prepare, using that bacteria, we will prepare a cell culture. Then next we would require an enzyme which will cut our gene of interest, because we cannot utilize the entire DNA, so we have to extract our gene of interest. So the enzymes that we use in this process, they are known as restriction enzymes, also known as molecular scissors. So these enzymes are very specific, they recognize a specific sequence, and they'll cut at a particular between the particular bases, so that we get an overhang which is present. So this overhang is actually the sticky end of the DNA that we are cleaving. So molecular scissors will recognize a specific sequence, cleave at a particular site and it will produce a single stranded overhang which is called as the sticky end. Then we require the vector which will carry the foreign gene of interest or foreign DNA into the host organism. And same, this vector would be cut by the same enzyme which was used to cut the gene of interest. Then we also require the enzyme called as DNA ligase, which will join the two different DNAs, the vector as well as the gene of interest. So that is known, DNA ligase is therefore known as molecular glue. So when we combine the plasmids, for example, we are using plasmid as a vector, and when it is joined with the gene of interest, we call it as a recombinant plasmid, and the DNA is called as the recombinant DNA. And lastly, we require the host organism into which this has to be inserted. So let's understand the process, how it is happening. So you can see in this slide, so recombinant DNA technology, it is joining together of DNA molecules from two different species that are inserted into a host organism to produce new genetic combinations, and that are of value to science, medicine, agriculture and industry. So as you can see in this slide, so there are two DNA, one is the vector DNA and other is the foreign DNA. So here we are considering the example of EcoR1, which is the restriction enzyme, which recognizes a specific sequence, that is GAATTC, and it would always cut between G and A. So we use this enzyme to cut both the vector DNA as well as the foreign DNA, which is then producing a sticky end, the single stranded overhang, which is called as the sticky end, and then using DNA ligase, the sticky ends are joined, giving us the recombinant DNA. And then this recombinant DNA is transferred to the host organism. So in this slide, we can see how it is being done. So there's a donor DNA, then there is a vector DNA, which is being cleaved, producing overhangs. And then the DNA ligase is added, which will seal the overhangs. And then it is inserted into the bacterial cells. So when the bacterial cells, this plasmid would multiply, and the bacteria would also divide, they'll multiply, producing large number of clones. So this is how we do recombinant DNA technology. So the applications of genetic engineering. So this can be used for protein manufacture, for example, insulin, which is used to treat diabetes mellitus, growth hormone, which is used to treat pituitary dwarfism, erythropoietin for anemia, and interferons for viral infections. Then we can prepare enzymes, for example, proteases, which are used for manufacture of detergents, amylases for manufacture of beer, bread, and textiles. Antibiotics can be prepared, and vaccines for rabies and hepatitis B have also been developed. Now let's understand how are transgenic organisms being made. So a transgenic organism is a genetically engineered organism carrying the foreign gene, and this foreign gene is called as the transgene. So what are the usefulness of using transgenic organisms? So we can use it to study diseases. For example, there's a disease and we want to see how it is affecting the body of a person. So we can prepare a transgenic animal, and we can see how the disease is developing so that effective drugs can be manufactured for it. Then this is also used to produce biological products. For example, Rosie cow was the first transgenic animal which was prepared, which was made, and this organism, this cow, produced protein-enriched milk, and it was rich in alpha-lactalbumin. Then we can use it to test vaccine safety. So transgenic mice have been prepared to test the vaccine safety. So polio vaccine is being tested on these mice. Then this transgenic organisms can also be used to study the normal physiology and development. So we can prepare transgenic animals, and there we can study the how the normal functioning of the body is taking place, how the genes are being expressed, and various functions they are being affected. So next is the methodology for production of transgenics. So we can use microinjection of the recombinant DNA into the fertilized eggs, or retroviral vectors can be used, which are so using retrovirus, the which is carrying the recombinant DNA, it is injected into the embryo before it is implanted. So let's study how agrobacterium can be used to create transgenic plants. So agrobacterium has a plasmid which is carrying the genes which is responsible for causing tumors. So this bacteria, when it infects the plant, it causes tumor or galls in the plant. So the gene which is present is called as the tDNA, and the plasmid is called as the TI plasmid, that is tumor inducing plasmid. So scientists have been able to use this this plasmid to basically manipulate the vector, the plasmid, so as that it does not cause the tumor, but it can transfer our gene of interest. So there is this TI plasmid in which is having the tDNA, which also has the restriction site for restriction enzyme to act. So in this tDNA, there is insertion of gene which is our gene of interest, and to create a recombinant TI plasmid. And then this recombinant TI plasmid is introduced into plant cells, and then this plant, the plants are allowed to grow and they are allowed to replicate, and we get a plant with a new trait. So this is how we have been able to prepare BT cotton, which is resistance against bollworms. Next we talk about bioremediation. So bioremediation is the process where we are using genetically modified microbes or bacteria mainly to clean up the environment. So these have been genetically modified so as they can convert the toxic chemicals which are present in the environment into non-toxic forms. So this is how bioremediation is done. So we all have studied about genes, that these are the hereditary units, and so the central dogma says that the DNA will give the information for the RNA through transcription, which will then further translate into proteins. So this is a normal process, but there might be times when the gene is mutated and we get a defective protein, or a defective phenotype is produced, which can be you know, life threatening for a person. So there we come to the genetic engineering comes to our rescue. So gene therapy. Gene therapy is the introduction of genes into existing cells to prevent or cure a wide range of diseases. It is a technique for correcting defective genes responsible for disease development. Scientists are using various approaches to gene therapy, which include replacing the mutated gene, or completely inactivating or knocking out the mutated gene, or introducing a new gene which will help us to fight the disease. So just a simple process in simple terms, let's understand. So there's a cell which is having a defective gene. So in this cell, a healthy gene is introduced and the cell function is restored. There are two types of gene therapy: somatic cell gene therapy and germline gene therapy. So in case, as the name suggests, somatic cell gene therapy, that means here the somatic cells are being altered, whereas in germline gene therapy, it, the therapeutic genes are transferred to the germ cells. So because it is in case of somatic gene therapy, the somatic cells are carrying our desired gene or the new gene, so therefore these are not inherited. But in case of germline gene therapy, the traits are further inherited, which also invites various ethical issues, and therefore this is not much in use. And scientists are mainly working upon somatic cell gene therapy. Somatic gene therapy can be in vivo gene therapy or in ex vivo gene therapy. So in case of in vivo gene therapy, what is done is the treatment gene is added to a vector. And the vectors commonly used are adenovirus, which is then delivered directly to the patient by injection. But in case of ex vivo gene therapy, the patient's cells are extracted from the body into which the therapeutic gene is added. Now here the vector used are mainly retrovirus. And now these, so we take out these stem cells which are now injected with the Using retroviral vectors, we have added our treatment gene, therapeutic gene, and these cells are then cultured, which are then in returned to the patient. And this is how the there are two types of somatic cell gene therapy. There's also another type of gene therapy, that is the antisense gene therapy. So under normal situations, so DNA will transcribe to form mRNA, which will then translate into protein. But in antisense gene therapy, we introduce these genes which will code for a sequence complementary to the mRNA, and then this will go and bind to the mRNA, forming a double-stranded mRNA which will inhibit or stop its translation, and hence the protein will not be produced. So this is normally done in cases where there is overproduction of proteins, for example in cancer cells. So there we can use antisense gene therapy. So here are some examples of the diseases and the target cells. For example, severe combined immunodeficiency, the target cells are bone marrow cells or T lymphocytes. For hemophilia, it's the liver or the muscles, fibroblasts or bone marrow cells. For cystic fibrosis, the lungs, the airways. In case of cancers, there are antigen presenting cells, blood progenitor cells, fibroblasts, T cells, brain, liver, pancreas, etc. So, what are the advantages of using gene therapy? Gene therapy has the potential to eliminate and prevent hereditary diseases such as cystic fibrosis, adenosine deaminase deficiency. It is also possible to cure heart diseases, AIDS and cancer. It gives someone born with a genetic disease a chance to live. It can be used to eradicate diseases from the future generations and preventing cancer cells from developing new blood vessels and angiogenesis. So this is how we can use gene therapy, but along with the advantages, there also comes challenges. So challenges like delivering the gene of interest to the correct cell, it might get, and it should be integrated into the correct position, correct location. If it goes and binds at a wrong chromosome, it will start producing a defective gene or might defective protein, or it might inhibit the existing protein which is being produced. So it has to be delivered to the correct place, correct location. Then there's another challenge of introducing changes into the germline. It might produce immune response in the person. And so the success requires efficient delivery, the correct gene, the correct cells, and the correct tissue. So basically, through this chapter, we have understood how we can use biotechnology in various fields, how we can use biotechnology to fight diseases, to produce new products. Then in industries, we can use it to produce curd, cheese, and then further how antibiotics can be produced, how we can use it to clean the environment. So scientists are investing a lot of their research into biotechnology to explore new avenues where we can further use it for benefit of the humankind. Thank you.